Hello and thanks for watching Proactive. I'm joined by Ross Orr. He's the President and CEO of BacTech Environmental Corporation. Ross, very good to meet you.
Thanks. Good to be here.
So Ross, for those viewers not familiar with the company, can you give us a bit of the history of BacTech Environmental?
Sure. It started at King's College in London, England, back in the late 80s as a way of looking at taking sulfur out of coal. Because of the energy crisis that we had in the 80s, they were looking for a cheaper way to, you know, produce power. And England, of course, has a lot of coal, but it's also has a lot of sulfur in it. And the bacteria get their energy by oxidizing sulfides. A couple of friends of mine now came along and said, forget coal, we're doing this for gold. And off the technology went to Perth, Australia. And effectively, the first plant they licensed was in 94, called You and Me in Western Australia. Another one they built in Tasmania ran for 15 years until the mine finally ran out of ore. And then they built a plant in China in 2001 and doubled the capacity of that in 2008. And then I split the company in half about 2011 into a mineral processing technology and an environmental technology. And I saw the future for the technology on the environmental side. And I think that's being proven now by who our shareholders are and what our goals are.
So tell us about the technology and how you're deploying it, Ross.
Well, our tagline is our bugs eat rocks, because that's basically what they're doing. And it's a great showstopper at a convention when that's all you have in your booth is our bugs eat rocks, because people stop and they look and they say, okay, what does that mean? So if you can imagine a brick wall and the bacteria are going after the mortar, and eventually the mortar is gone and everything comes crashing down. So anything that's that is soluble in acid, because the tanks are very, very, very acidic, like copper, nickel, cobalt, arsenic, they go into solution. Anything that's not reactive to acid, like gold, silver, and PGMs, goes another way. So at the end of 6 days of the bacteria basically chewing away at these sulfides, you effectively have a solid liquid separation. You've now got oxidized gold that goes off to make a doré. And then we use limestone to raise the pH in the tanks. And things happen. Like if you remember from chemistry class, iron and arsenic band together and drop out as a ferric arsenate, which is an EPA landfillable material. And the water's recycled and the process continues. It's a continuous process. It's not batch.
So you have been deploying this technology primarily in Ecuador, but also in other jurisdictions, including in Ontario.
Yeah, we're looking at pyrrhotite tailings in the Sudbury Basin, of which there's somewhere between 75 and 100 million tons of this sort of low-grade nickel cobalt product that's sitting there in lakes. And it's in lakes because pyrrhotite is very volatile. It'll burst into flames if it's just left out in the open, because it's always trying to oxidize itself. You can't make money at the grades of nickel and cobalt that are in this material, but what if you could do something with the iron? There's a lot of iron that's generated. Maybe it goes into steel making. Maybe it goes into the batteries, the large scale batteries. What do you do with the sulfur? Maybe you can precipitate out elemental sulfur and sell that to the industry for, sulfuric acid. And then the back end is what can you make with what's left over in a geopolymer? Can you build it into bricks? Can you build it into stone? That technology is advancing quite rapidly. So what you're looking for is the sum of the parts is worth more than the whole. And there's a lot of nickel there, even at 0.85%. It's still in the teens of billions, 15 billion or so.
I mean, in fact, you say on your website that you plan to liberate billions of dollars of battery materials from tailings in Ontario in the Sudbury Basin.
Yeah, that's the pyrrhotite. All right, this is stuff that nobody wanted. Pentlandite is where the good nickel grades are, and that's what they used through the smelters and whatnot. This stuff was dumped into lakes because they couldn't allow it to oxidize, so they had to put it underwater. But there's upwards of 100 million tons of this material.
Okay, and you're planning a new bioleaching facility in Ecuador. Also have your eyes on Peru and Colombia. So take us through your business model and how you plan to commercialize all this, Ross.
Okay, so we were invited to Ecuador a number of years ago to look at tailings because the area that we're in Ponce Enriquez or Tengel produces a lot of arsenopyrite, and the arsenic levels in this stuff is really high. And of course, when you mine it and then you make a concentrate through flotation, you get arsenic levels as high as 20% of the concentrate. There's only one buyer for that material, and it's the Chinese. And of course, they were paying sort of 65 to 70 cents on the dollar for the gold. And then the Chinese government imposed an import tax on high arsenic gold concentrates. And they just passed it on to the miners, who are now getting 50 cents on the dollar. So what we want to do is build a bioleach plant in that area, keep the value at home, provide terrific wages, I mean, compared to what's offered in the area, and produce this arsenopyrite in country. So our first plant, which is relatively small, is going to produce about 30,000 ounces a year, but we'll immediately go into an expansion once it's up and running because the market is five times the size of that. So we theoretically could be producing over 100,000 ounces of gold from that area at margins that run sort of 25 to 30%. And we have a 12-year tax holiday as well.
So take us through the potential to expand into Peru and Colombia.
Well, people forget that 20 years ago, we did a pilot plant or a demonstration plant with Peñoles of Mexico, and it was for copper. So energite or energite, depending where you're from, is very prevalent in northern Peru, which is a copper gold arsenic sulfide. Everything flows down to Trujillo, which is the port in northern Peru. You could basically dump a plant on the outskirts of Trujillo and capture all this material as it's heading out towards China. Our biggest holdback has always been capital. I mean, if we had access to capital and people calling this a new technology, which it's not, they just haven't heard about it. You could build one of these a year for 5 years and be producing, several hundred thousand ounces of gold a year and copper and silver and stopping arsenic from going into rivers, which is where it's going now.
So, I mean, you basically have an environmental plan ahead of you as well as social governance. Take us through that.
Well, as opposed to being a big, ugly miner and coming in and firing everybody and throwing them off the property, we told the people that worked on the farm that we're not in the cocoa tree business. They're welcome to stay and operate the 80 acres we're not using right now, continue to harvest the cocoa and sell it for their own account. We also said, look, when we do eventually expand into your backyard, we'll hire you in the plant. And it went over very well. And so that's one aspect of the social side of things that we're trying to do. We don't want to be the ugly neighbor who moves in and immediately starts battling with anybody. We have one piece left in our environmental process, which is the consultation. And the biggest question we get is, where do I apply for a job? Because we're not digging anything out of the ground. We're in essence, we're filling it back in again. So nobody complains or fights about environmental cleanups, which is nice. So we're pretty confident we're going to get our permits shortly.
Well, talking of neighbors, you decided to go the OTCQB route, started trading on the OTCQB last month. Why did you decide to go that route?
Well, I would say, I mean, we've got an email distribution list of about 4,000 people, and I would say that 70% of the people that open those emails are Americans, or at least they have American addresses. So it only made sense. We're not big enough to qualify yet for the QX, but that'll be the next step probably. And eventually, I guess you want to make it all the way to NASDAQ or whatever, and the TSX for that matter. It just makes it easier for people. When we were on the pink sheets, it was a nightmare for anybody trying to buy our shares. Most of the brokers won't touch you because you are on the pink sheets. So it only made sense that we had to upgrade, and we did it. So we're happy to do it.
And are you seeing investor interest, Ross?
Well, I'd say the second day of trading, we traded about 250,000 shares, which was interesting. Chris Temple, who writes the National Investor in the States, writes about us a lot. And usually you see activity on the QB when he's written something as an update on what we're doing. So,
well, hopefully you're doing it right. So what sorts of catalysts should your investors be looking out for, Ross?
Well, the two prevalent ones are permitting And about 10 days ago, they signed off on the environmental side. So as I said, the only thing remaining now is the consultation, which we're waiting for the government to come out with the new rules. I mean, once we get the rules, it'll be another 45 days before we get that. But the big one's the financing. As I said, everybody says, well, this is new technology. You know, I want to be second. Come after you build the first one, come and see me. Well, no, it's too late for that. The rewards go to the people that step up to the plate now. So we've got a number of different discussions going on with various groups. I mean, I'm obviously not at liberty to say who or where we're at, but we've sussed out a lot of potential, believe me, that people you wouldn't think of that are now looking at this sort of approach to mining from an environmental basis. Everybody's trying to be green all of a sudden, you know, and we've been there for 10 years. Just, you know, what do you want to call us this year? CSR, ESG? We just call it common sense.
Ross, I hope you'll keep us posted on your progress. Thank you very much for the introduction today.
Yeah, my pleasure.
Ross Orr, President and CEO of BacTech Environmental.